Good morning, guys. How's everybody doing? Cool. All right, great. Grab your Bibles, if you would, please. Like Pastor Ryan said, we're on the last week of our Samson series this weekend. We're going to be looking at Judges chapter 16, and we'll look at verses 23 to 31. If you'll get used to digging into your Bible with us here in church, you'll probably do a lot better at digging into it on your own, which is what we really encourage you to do. Judges 16, verses 23 to 31. I read about a man who opened a new business. He was a brand new business owner, and when he opened the business, he received a bouquet of flowers, and he was pretty surprised to see that he had gotten a bouquet of flowers for opening his business, but he was more surprised at the card that he received along with it. The card read, "Deepest Sympathy." Strange thing. He was puzzling about that, thinking about it, wondering why it is that he got a card that said "Deepest Sympathy" for opening a business when the phone rang. So he answers the telephone, and it was the florist. The florist apologizes for sending the wrong card on the wrong set of flowers. He said it was supposed to go to a funeral, and you were supposed to have the other one. And the business owner said, "Well, that's okay. You know, I'm in business. I know we can make mistakes." And the florist said, "Well, no, that's not the biggest problem. The biggest problem is that your card went to the funeral." And he said, "Oh, really? What did it say?" And the florist said, "Congratulations on your new location." So we're going to talk about a really fun subject as we finish up the Samson series today. We're going to talk about death. We're going to talk about death, and I want you to think about it as we get going. It's not something that we think about very often, at least not most of us. We live in a world, I believe, where the emphasis seems to be more and more in the wrong place. See if you can identify with me on this. We seem to be spending a whole lot more time on something temporary than we do on something permanent. More and more, it seems like we think about physical health, which I'm all for, but we spend more time thinking about that and working on that than we do about lasting spiritual health. Another example, I think, is that we put our hopes, a lot of us put our hopes into a few years of retirement at the end of our lives instead of an eternity that's going to come after that. And what we're doing as we think about that, we're avoiding the inevitable. Do you get a hold of that? I mean, we're avoiding the fact that we are going to die. We're avoiding the fact that we're not putting anything into the real retirement plan. The fact is that we're going to last for an eternity somewhere. And, you know, Jesus said about this, he said, "Storing up treasures on earth that are subject to moths and rust and where thieves come in and break in and steal." All of these things are temporal and we can't really protect them. But he said, rather, what we should be doing is making treasures in heaven rather than on earth, treasures that last forever. Seems like we just plain don't believe that we're going to die. We just don't think about that. I read about a poll that an insurance agency did, or an insurance company did, and they were asking people about when they die, and people's general response to that was, "Well, if I die..." And then they'd fill in the blank. So people most generally just have the idea that that's just not going to happen. Anybody with me? It's just not something that's going to take place. So I think we put it out of our minds. We don't think about it much. And maybe that's understandable. But it's also something that we need to consider because it is inevitable. It is going to happen. Today, as we talk about our text, as we work through it, we get a little bit of help with thinking about death, with thinking about the end and what that looks like and being prepared for it. I want to remind you of where we've come from. Samson is in a Philistine prison at this point. He's humbled. He's in a Philistine prison. The Philistines have gathered in their temple, the temple to Dagon, and they're planning on offering this great sacrifice to their god. And it's a national celebration because they've captured Samson. Samson was public enemy number one, right? He was public enemy number one. They've captured him, and they're going to make a big spectacle out of him. They're going to make a national celebration out of it. And so they're all excited. And so people from everywhere have gathered into this temple of Dagon to celebrate the fact that they've gotten a hold of Samson, who's caused them so much trouble in the past. We pick up the story at verse 25. And it says here, and when their hearts were merry, that is, when the Philistine hearts were merry, they said, call Samson that he may entertain us. So they called Samson out of the prison, and he entertained them, and they made him stand between the pillars. Stop right there for a moment. It's important for us to notice that this was an immense event, and the bulk of the conversation that was taking place among all of these thousands of people here in the temple was surrounding the capture of Samson. They were all talking about it. They were excited about it. It was the buzz that was going on. And so what it says here is, when their hearts were merry, and I want you to understand that what that means is when they were good and drunk. When they were, the phrase literally means when they had drank enough to be silly. Are you with me? Somebody say I'm with you? That's when this massive crowd begins to chant. And they begin to decide, just like a game, right? When everybody gets enough, they start to chant. And this massive crowd begins to appeal to the leaders that are among them. And here's what they say. Call Samson that he may entertain us. Call Samson that he may entertain us. Now, somebody might think at this point, that's really weird. What'd they do, train him to dance while he was in prison? You know, is it the Philistine version of Dancing with the Stars, or what's going on here? They really, what they wanted to do was see Samson. It was a little bit like capturing King Kong and then just reading about it in the newspaper. That wasn't good enough. It wasn't good enough to talk about it. We want to see this giant man that's caused us so much trouble. Anybody with me? We want to see this guy. In fact, there were probably a good number of people that came to the temple that day just hoping to get a glimpse of him because he was in the same city. So they said, call Samson that he may entertain us. I want you to notice what that word entertain means. It's a very important word for us to understand. The word entertain in the ESV is the original Hebrew word tsaka, which talks about mocking and laughing. Mocking and laughing. So entertain isn't necessarily the best translation for that word. It was all about mocking and laughing at Samson. That's what they wanted to do. That was the entertainment that they desired. Do you see that? They wanted to mock Samson. They wanted to make him the brunt of their jokes. They wanted to be able to laugh at him. He'd caused him a lot of pain, a lot of trouble. And so the Philistine leaders wanted to make the most of this deal, this celebration. And so their request was granted. The people were chanting, bring him out, bring him out. And their request was granted. So what we see is, the text says, they called Samson out of the prison and he entertained them. He didn't do much. He stood there. In fact, we see that he's the center of the entertainment. They made him stand between the pillars, and what that means is he was center stage. He was right in the center of things between the two main pillars so that everybody in the temple could get a look at Samson. So they mocked and they laughed and they poked at him. And apparently what we see next in the text is this. There was a young Philistine man who had been assigned to leading Samson around wherever the lords of the Philistines wanted him. It looks to me like what's being said here is that Samson was weak and he was blind by now, and he was unable to do anything for himself. You remember the Philistines have gouged his eyes out. They believe they've taken away his strength, amen? So they see him as weak and blind and unable to do anything for himself. Is that really what was going on? Is that really what had happened to him? Or did he already understand that what looked like a terrible tragedy right now was really a fantastic opportunity? Did he already know that? Well, it kind of seems that way, because look at verse 26. Verse 26 tells us, and Samson said to the young man who held him by the hand, let me feel the pillars, now watch this, on which the house rests. How many of you see those are Samson's words? I look at that and I say, wait a minute. Something's not right here. Samson has somehow gained some knowledge of the temple. He knows something about the temple. How does he know how the temple is constructed? How has he figured that out? Well, as we've studied Samson, as we've studied Judges chapters 15 and 16, one of the things that we saw at the beginning of chapter 16 was that Samson took a trip to Gaza. Chapter 16, verse 1. Samson went to Gaza. Do you remember this? And do you also remember that we were never given a reason for him to go? We know he got in trouble there, but we don't know why he went in the first place. Why did he go to Gaza? One thing we do know about that trip to Gaza, at chapter 16, verse 1, is that when he got to Gaza, he somehow slipped into that Philistine city without anyone knowing about it. So the question is this, was he on a spy mission? Was he checking out the temple to see what he could do to tear it down? Because that was the primary place among the Philistines that they gathered? Is that what he was doing? At any rate, Samson now appealed to the compassion of the young man who was holding his hand. Take a look with me now at the way Samson does this. Let me feel the pillars on which the house rests, that I may lean against them. That I may lean against them. So Samson insinuates that he has no strength, right? He insinuates that he needs something to rest on because he's wiped out. He's got nothing left. He's weak. He's helpless. He's beaten. At this point, we get an indication of what's going on in that temple. It's an amazing thing what's happening with the Philistine celebration. It's important information for what's going to happen here in a few lines. But verse 27 tells us that the house was full. Somebody say full. Full of men and women. The term house there, by the way, simply means structure. So it's a temple. We know that from previous verses. But the word house means structure. So we're told that that structure, the temple, was full, literally full of men and women. Then we find out who's in attendance a little bit there at verse 27. All the lords of the Philistines were there. Now let that sink in for just a second. All the lords of the Philistines were there. Every Philistine leader was there. Every one of them. In other words, here's the thing. Every leader from every one of the five city-states of the Philistines had left their city-state to come to Gaza and see Samson for this celebration. Do you see that? Every one of the leaders from the five city-states were there. There was not one single Philistine nobleman in the entire country that was not in that temple at that moment. In fact, we find out there was standing room only. Verse 27 goes on. And on the roof, there were 3,000 men and women who looked on while Samson entertained. So there wasn't any room on the floor anymore. But the way that the temple was built was there was a balcony around the outside on the roof, and it was open in the center. Samson was between the two pillars, and all of these people then gathered on the roof because there wasn't any room on the floor anymore. 3,000 on the roof. 3,000. That's when Samson does something that's very rare. Something that we have not seen Samson do, but only one time before he now does. Verse 28. Then Samson called to the Lord. Then Samson called to the Lord. Samson called out to God for help. The only other time we've seen him do that, he's a brash, prideful guy, amen? The only other time we've seen him do that in the text is Judges 15 and verse 18. But here again we see Samson called to the Lord. I would just encourage you to think about something. Somebody say, I'll think. Everybody say, I'll think. All right, good job. Long before anyone calls to the Lord, God has called them. Let that sink into you for a minute. Long before anybody calls to the Lord, God has called to them. Here's what we know about Samson. Samson has been in prison. Samson's had his eyes taken away. Samson's been the prison mule. All he's doing is grinding grain all day. He's been humbled. Anybody hearing me? The Bible says he's been humbled. Now he calls to the Lord. Guess what all that was? That was God calling to Samson. Can anybody find themselves in that position? God's saying, hey, wake up! Time to wake up! Time for you to know who you need. Amen? That's what's going on with Samson. I want to pause with you just for a minute so that we can think about those important words. Samson called to the Lord. Those words are, they're in the Bible from the beginning to the end. You find those words everywhere from Genesis to Revelation in God's Word. But they're really misunderstood and misused words. I would encourage you as we study this to understand what it means to call on God. It's a critical, critical thing to understand in your life, what it means to call on God. I would take you over to chapter 10, Romans 10 and verse 13 for kind of the culmination text on calling on the Lord. Romans chapter 10 and verse 13, God's truth says this, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Will be saved. Let's think for a moment about the word saved. What's he talking about? He's talking about being saved immediately from the penalty of sin. What is the penalty of sin? Death. To be saved immediately from the penalty of sin, which is death, that is separation from God for eternity. He's also talking about the important second phase of salvation that's so often missed, and I want you to hear this because so many people miss this and don't understand it. He's talking about being saved progressively from the power of sin. So that if I'm saved immediately from the penalty of sin, then I will be saved progressively from the power of sin. In other words, over time, from that moment on, sin will have less and less power in my life. That's what it means to be saved. Thirdly, he's talking about being saved ultimately from the presence of sin. The third phase of salvation, which is heaven. So that I'm no longer even in the presence of sin. Doesn't that sound good? In order to be there, I have to be saved immediately from the penalty of sin and then begin to be saved progressively from the power of sin. Too many of us have come to believe that what happened was I said a prayer once and Jesus saved me and nothing ever happened again. That's not what the Bible describes as salvation or being saved. It is not. In fact, this is not an isolated statement about how to obtain salvation. It is not. Too many people have seen it that way, but previous to this verse, you have to understand that at Romans 10:9, he said, "If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." Immediately from the penalty of sin, progressively from the power that sin has over you for the rest of your life, and finally, ultimately, from the presence of sin. So here's what we're talking about, friends. Listen. Salvation, listen close. True faith, that is saving faith, is active and ongoing. It's not momentary one time and everything's done. Saving faith, faith that saves you, is active today and ongoing for the rest of your life. Somebody say, I hear you. That point is further emphasized by the fact that this phrase at Romans 10:13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, is actually taken from the Old Testament. It's borrowed from Joel in the Old Testament. So I want to show you something about Old Testament salvation. Let me just show you a couple of verses that help us understand what God's talking about when he says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. The first verse I would show you is Psalm 79, verse 6, where he says this. This is a psalm. Now listen to me. Some of you don't even understand that you can call on God when you're really frustrated. You can call on God when you're really angry. You can call on God when you want somebody to burn. Somebody hear me? I mean, how many of you know that sometimes we want somebody to burn? Let's be honest. You're like, we're in church. We can't do that. No, really. You know what you can do? How many of you have ever been mad enough that you want to see somebody burn? Okay, there's a lot of honest people here and some really dishonest people here. Fact is that sometimes we want to, if they could go up in flames in front of us, that would be great. Right? Listen to what he says. And remember it. You can call out to God like this. God, pour out your anger on the nations that do not know you and on the kingdoms that do not call upon your name. I'm sick of it. Right? I'm sick of it. How about some instruction? Here's another one. Here he tells us, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. God is telling you, here's what he's doing. He's saying to you, I'm giving you invitation now to call upon my name. That's what I want you to do. Thirdly, how about this? Here's his personal experience, the psalmist's personal experience. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Oh Lord, I pray, deliver my soul. So he took his own advice, and that's what he did. Who hears me? He called on the name of the Lord when he was in trouble. Deliver me. Help me. Get me out of this. Now here's what's important to understand. Stick in there. You ready? Here's what's important to understand. In every one of those instances, every one of those, the word Lord, somebody say Lord. Lord. The word Lord is the covenant name Yahweh. Every one of those. So when you talk about calling on the name of the Lord, what he's saying is call on not just any God, not just any old deity, not just anybody that you heard about, but the God of the Bible. The one whose word we're looking at right now. Call on him specifically. You can't randomly call on a God. You need to call specifically on a God. It's all about knowing him. Who sees that? So here, let's go back to these New Testament truth verses. And here, look again. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved immediately from the penalty of sin. Saved progressively from that time on, from the power that sin has had over them. Saved ultimately, finally, from the very presence of sin. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, what is that name? Romans 10, verse 9, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. God's word teaching us that there's only one to call on. Amen. Only one. Consider carefully what he's telling us to do in His love for us. I want to caution you this morning. The danger is always present. The danger is this. Hey, I listened to some guy this morning, and now I know Jesus. I have no doubt that today God could move in your heart and you could commit your life to the Lord Jesus. But you need to understand that you need to know Him, because on Judgment Day, God's Word lovingly tells us that He will stand before many. Listen to me closely. Don't let somebody miss this. He will stand and He will say, "I never knew you." Today, if you give your life to Jesus, it must be an ongoing relationship. You must come to know Jesus. We are committed to you coming to know Jesus, not having an experience. That means that you must submit to His authority. You must submit to His sovereignty. You must submit to His power, His majesty, His Word. Yeah, every bit of it. Not what you choose, but every bit of it. And then you obtain His grace. True saving faith is not a momentary verbal, mental assent to Christ. I want you to understand that even James in God's Word says that even the demons believe. How many of you know it doesn't save them? Calling on the name of the Lord means a lifestyle change. It means a lifestyle of faith, not a fleeting moment that's gone. This is what happened in Samson's life. Let's work through this quickly as we finish up. In Samson's life, we see Samson calling to the Lord and saying, "Oh God, please remember me. Please remember me." Now he's done this twice, as we pointed out. Amen? He's called to God twice, as we pointed out. But I want you to understand the difference in the two times that he's called to God. Watch this now. So important for my life and yours. The first time he cries out to God, it was to save his life. The last time he cries out to God, it's in his death. May I just say to you very clearly what God's Word is teaching us is this. Unless you call out to God in life, unless you call out to the name of the Lord in life, you've got no business calling out to him in death. Is somebody hearing me? So Samson cries out to God in his death. Here he's calling out to Jesus to save him, to save his, to let him be useful, to ensure him that in his death he will see God. I might point out to you that when you're dying, it's an easy place to cry out to God from. Anybody with me? It's maybe a little bit easier when I know I've only got a minute, right? Is that true? See, it reminds me of the thief on the cross. Have you heard the story? We're heading into Easter. We're heading into Good Friday, and it reminds me, there he is, this thief dying on the cross. And no way out. I mean, he's nailed up there, literally nailed. He's dying. Nowhere to go. True? And we see the text tells us at Luke 23:42 that Jesus is there next to him. And this thief looks over at Jesus and says, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." So watch what happened here. He called out to God in such a correct way. He called on the name of the Lord in such a correct way. Do you see that? That he was saved right there. Saved from what? The penalty of sin, right? Now, I want you to understand something. A lot of people have looked at that story, and it's prompted them to say, "Well, I'll just wait until I'm about ready to go then." I'll just wait until the end and then I'll call on the name of the Lord and I'll be saved. I'll get my bases covered then and I'll just do what I want with my life now. Here's the problem. Would you listen to the problem with that? The problem with that is this. At that time, unless you somehow call on the name of the Lord in a correct way, with the correct faith, that would have been life-transforming faith, you're not saved. And here's the problem with that. If I really had that kind of belief in Jesus, watch, would I have tried to keep my life for myself and not give it to Him to begin with? Did anybody get that? The answer to that is no, I would have given my life to Him. He'd have been worthy of that in my heart. Right? He'd have been worthy of my life. Fact is, you would have submitted your life to Jesus, been saved immediately from the penalty, been saved progressively from that time on, from the power that sin had had over you, so that you could ultimately be saved from the presence of sin. That's ongoing faith. Do you get that? That's why I got to tell you, God repeatedly warns us. He says, you're dust. You know what dust is? Gone. He repeatedly, lovingly warns us, you know, you're not going to last. Life comes and goes. Teach us to number our days aright that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Wisdom comes from knowing you don't have forever. You're not even guaranteed another minute. Samson has at least to some degree gained that heart of wisdom. Right? I mean, how many of you know that right now he kind of knows the end is coming? And we can imagine, we can visualize these evil Philistines, and that's what they are. We can imagine them mocking and laughing at him as he prays and he cries out to God. Verse 28, Samson praying, O Lord God, please remember me and please strengthen me only this once, O God, that I may be avenged on the Philistines for my two eyes. And how they must have ridiculed and cackled at him all the more when at verse 29, Samson grasped the two middle pillars on which the house rested. And he leaned his weight, watch now, leaned his weight against them, right hand on one, left hand on the other. This beated, defeated man, blind man in chains, this prison mule, this ridiculed, beaten joke, this fool. Are you getting it? Are you staying with me? Samson prayed once more, verse 30, and Samson said, God, let me die with the Philistines. And as the Philistines mocked him, verse 30, he bowed with all his strength, and the house fell on the Lord's and upon all the people who were in it. Now it's honesty time again. That story makes the man in me go, yeah! Kill them all! You know why? You know why it does that to us? Glory. Glory. I'm a glory hound. I said it was honesty time. I'm a glory hound. Man, I don't tell you what, I got a pride problem a mile wide. Stay with me. Don't get caught up in somebody moving around. Listen, are you listening? Very important. Very important. How many of you are a glory hound? Again, we got some honesty and some deception. How many of you know it's a problem by now? How many of you know it takes you the wrong direction by now? How many of you know it's true that pride goes before the fall by now? So the problem is this. I see this and I do the yeah thing, you know? It's easy to do stuff for glory and not for God. Amen? Glory is a huge motivator. The challenge is this. I want you to listen carefully. The challenge is this. The challenge is that's old that's old covenant stuff. And we're in a new covenant under Christ's blood. And I want you to listen closely. We're called to a different death. We are called to a different death. See, you come to the New Testament and you don't find anybody going out in a blaze of glory anymore. You don't even find anybody getting to live in a blaze of glory anymore. You don't get to find anybody saying that they're having their best life now that really knows Jesus. You don't get that in the New Covenant. You don't. In fact, Jesus is our example. Jesus is our example. Check it out with me. Philippians 2 verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves. Follow closely every word. Have this mind among yourselves. Who sees it? Which is yours in Christ Jesus. So if you know him, amen? Christ who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but instead emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross, the worst way. So watch now. Don't you see this as the getting off point for most people? Are you hearing what I'm saying? This, how many of you know it's like this? Yeah, I want to be on the highway with following Jesus. Yeah. And then it's all Jesus, no glory. Ooh. Exit. This is the getting off point for most people right here. Don't get away from me. It always has been the getting off point for most people. I'm not just making that up or saying that's what Lynn thinks. Listen, Peter wanted it that way. He wanted to fight his way to glory. You go back to the story and Jesus is in the garden and he's about to be arrested. And what does Peter do? This giant fisherman grabs a hold of a sword and what does he want to do? He wants to fight his way to glory. Who hears me? Yeah, we're going to take this kingdom by force, man. That's what we're going to do. And guess what? Jesus says, no, that's not the way it's going to go down. I'm going to allow myself to be crucified. That's what needs to happen here. That's why I came. And that's when Peter, listen, that's when Peter and the rest of the disciples, at least for the moment, went, no thanks. Are you catching it? If I can die in a blaze of glory, maybe I'll do that. Maybe I'll do that. That would be great. But if I have to die with somebody taking advantage of me, if I have to let someone take advantage of me, if I have to let them mock and laugh at me and do nothing about it, exit. That's when I walk away from Jesus and do my own thing. And Jesus said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever would save his life, watch now, watch now, watch now, whoever would save his life will lose it. Is anybody catching that? But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. It might just say, we'll be saved. Right? Real faith, saving faith, does not try to keep life for yourself. Are you getting a hold of that? Listen to me closely now. As a real believer in Jesus Christ, as somebody who's committed their life to the Lord Jesus Christ, our lives are a daily self-crucifixion. At home, at work, whatever program I'm in, at school, at church. I take up my cross, moment to moment, I take up my cross, I'm following Jesus to Calvary, where my flesh, myself, is crucified, and Jesus comes through. Real faith, saving faith, is active and ongoing. Listen. It's when you want to be someone. Are you with me? It's when you want to be someone. It's when that opportunity comes, when your worth is challenged, when your value is challenged, when you think you're getting stepped on. That's when you cry out to God most. That's when you call out to God. That's when you say, I got to have your help right now. So as we finish up, what was Samson's epitaph? What did it say on his giant headstone? Go back to Judges 16 with me and we'll finish up. It says here, verse 30, the end of verse 30, so the dead whom he killed at his death were more than those whom he killed in his life. Again, remembering that was God's calling for him, was to save Israel and wipe out the Philistines. So he accomplished his God-given purpose there in his death. Do you see that? Verse 31, then his brothers and all his family came down and took his body and brought him up and buried him between Zorah and Eshtol in the tomb of Manoah his father. Now watch this. He had judged Israel 20 years. We get this, we get these few chapters of a story of Samson. And God does not include anything in there about some of the great things that Samson did. The story is much like the story of Jonah, where all we get is, here's some examples so that we don't set our hearts on evil. That's what we get out of Samson's story. But at the end, what we see is that he judged Israel for 20 years. What was Samson? Samson was a judge. He was somebody that sat in court and he helped maintain justice in Israel. And he made good decisions and he did good things for the Israelites. And we never get to see that picture of Samson. But the final say on Samson is at Hebrews 11 and verse 32, where it says, Samson, who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises, and stopped the mouths of lions. By faith, Samson was saved by faith. Samson was saved because he called on the name of the Lord, and he was immediately saved from the penalty of sin. And he was progressively saved from the power that sin had had over him. We see it at the end of his life, don't we? That God won. God won. Somebody say, God won. God won in Samson's life. God won. So that ultimately, he would not be in the presence of sin. He'd be in heaven. Point out just a couple of more things to you as we finish up. Listen closely. Both Samson and the Philistines died. Amen? Samson was ready. The Philistines were not. Now you have to ask yourself, am I an enemy of God? Or am I calling on the name of the Lord today? Am I going to be ready? Or am I not? Today is the day. I mean, I'm telling you, listen, you have an opportunity today to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. This is it. This is it. But don't make the mistake of saying, man, I got emotional and I gave my life to Jesus that day and everything was hunky-dory afterward. What he's asking for is nothing less than your whole life. Everything changes from this point on. Everything. I belong to him. My mouth belongs to him. My heart belongs to him. My feet go where he says to go. I do what he says to do. I belong to him. My heart doesn't make my decisions anymore. It's deceitful above all things. His word makes my decisions now. Today I give my life to Jesus, and that means the whole life. That's why he says count the cost. So Father God, we come to you now as we finish up here. Lord God, we ask your spirit to fall in a very heavy way on those whom you're speaking to. Father, that we would not be able to escape your hand of conviction. Lord, we consider now the cost, the cross. We know, God, that the cross is that place where your hatred of sin and your love for us collide. It's the only place where that happens. And so we know that there is no other name under heaven by which men must be saved. That is the name of Jesus. And so right now, perhaps there are some who would turn from their sin, that is repentance, turn from sin, all sin, not just that one that you'd love to be rid of because it's caused you so much trouble. No, all sin, whatever God calls wrong, whatever God calls a sin in his word, I turn from that. I turn from it. I turn to Jesus, trusting in him. Not in my own understanding, but in Jesus. I give myself, I give my life, I give all of me to Jesus. Knowing that if I am now giving my life to Jesus, that the next moment, the next day, the next hours will mean that I am progressively more and more and more being saved from the power that sin has had over me. I will have a hunger for his word. I will have a hunger to be in places where his word is taught. I'll have a deep desire to be in communication with God, to know him. God, you will be inside of me. You will have changed my heart. Father, we ask that it would be so in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.